Here's what's going down, Robbie. A coup is underway right now. We've been warning about this for years. People who've watched our Venezuela reporting, Mike's debunking of John Oliver, already kind of know that pretty much anything that you see regarding Venezuela in the corporate media is very skewed and propagandistic and littered with falsehoods. Pretty much the only accurate sources that you're going to get on what's happening in Venezuela are Telesur and Venezuela Analysis. And I really want to give a shout out to Venezuela Analysis because they are very important to support. They are a grassroots independent source on the ground, really cutting through this narrative. And you really are not seeing that elsewhere. And this is 24/7 pro-coup propaganda happening across the mainstream media.
From all sides.
Both parties, all sides, Democratic Party, Republican Party, everyone.
The only people, quickly, the only people who are really holding, locking this down and opposing it are like social, like openly socialist.
Yeah.
Or Marxist people. Like even I see just a lot of silence just on the general left about this right now.
Well, it's confusing.
Yeah.
It's very confusing. I was confused before I went there. It's a lot to take in. It's a lot to investigate and to really understand the situation. It's complicated as hell. And especially when you're talking about economics and sanctions and how like inflation works, it's very confusing. So I get like the kind of the absence of people weighing in, but at the same time, we should be absolutely unified in our opposition for U.S. regime change anywhere on the planet, if you call yourself remotely progressive. So the fact that there is such radio silence from so many people, I don't give a shit if you don't understand the economic complexities of Venezuela. Now we need to stand in unified fashion against what is going on. There was already whisperings of this going on because of Mike Pence tweeting.
Yep.
He tweeted, he said, it's time for a transition. Libertad. Rubio, Trump followed suit, as well as the Democratic Party, saying they are not recognizing Maduro as a legitimate president of Venezuela. So just for some context, Maduro was reelected democratically. This has been proven time and again. They have very fair and free democratic elections. Every vote can be proven. The problem is the opposition that has been vying for power since the election of Hugo Chavez has been trying to seize power by undemocratic means. They cannot win elections. So they try to foment violent, fascistic street battles. They try to seize power by undemocratic means. And they try to constantly call international bodies allied with the U.S. empire to overthrow its democratically elected leadership. Because why? Because the oligarchy is still alive and well in Venezuela. It still is very, very powerful. It's not a socialist country. It's a mixed economy. The corporations there still have inordinate control. They never lost the power that they have in that small sector. And so they've been sabotaging the economy in every single way that they can. In 2016, when the opposition won, finally, the first election since Hugo Chavez, they won power in the National Assembly. Since then, they've shut down any sort of ability for the National Assembly to pass bills, to pass laws, because their whole purpose is to sabotage the government. So they have perpetuated like the complete sabotage and tanking of the economy. And then they use the inaction and the, you know, the lack of coordination between bodies to say, look, we can't work with these people. Maduro is illegitimate. And so what happened was this new guy who's the head of the National Assembly. His name is Juan Guaidó. He's the head of the National Assembly. So what happened is he just declared himself president of Venezuela. And this is a couple weeks after Maduro was just sworn in to his second presidential term after winning a democratic election. See, the U.S. government and the opposition tried to boycott the election last time. They refused to participate. And an opposition person actually ended up running against Maduro and got fucking trounced. And so Maduro won again. And so what's the next step after they lose the elections? They have to foment regime change. They have to try to instigate a coup. So they know that these street battles and violent insurrections don't work. They've tried that time and again. We were in the middle of one ourselves the opposition protesters threatened to lynch and murder us, we had to flee from the country. They followed and stalked us here. Hundreds of death threats, lynch threats. They lynched black people alive, burned them alive in the streets. So because that didn't work, this is an unprecedented thing, Robbie, for just a random dude to just declare himself, I'm the fucking president. I am president of Venezuela today. And he would never have done this without a green light in advance, well in advance, from the U.S. and all of its proxy regime change fronts, the Organization of American States, and all the rest, the Lima operation. Group, whose essentially main purpose is to overthrow Venezuela. So now you see it's all going into place. So once they declared this guy as the legitimate president, you have Donald Trump immediately acknowledging his legitimacy as president, and I mean, all of these other organizations followed suit.
Before, you know, we've seen other people in his administration saying more neoconservative sounding things compared to what he says, like Nikki Haley, like Pompeo, mm-hmm. like Bolton, especially like on social media. And then a lot of the times he doesn't follow, he'll just like not say something about it.
Yeah.
He says some things about Iran sometimes, but compared to what like Nikki Haley and Pompeo and stuff have said, he's not said things nearly as harsh or militaristic as they have. But this is different, where it was like almost like clockwork. The same thing started before. Bolton, Pompeo, Pence were all saying things about this guy and officially recognizing him as president. And then Trump says it. Like at the end, he closes the circle. So this is a really serious, real thing. And it is clearly a regime change operation taking place right before our very eyes. And it also needs to be acknowledged that Trump has long talked about how he would have been for the Iraq war if we could just steal their oil. Well, guess what? Venezuela has one of the world's largest oil supplies. So it kind of matches up perfectly with Trump, not Bolton, not the neocons, but Trump specifically. Trump is a unique form of mixture between neocon outlier, you know, right populism, whatever you want to call it. This is something that fits perfectly within something that he would want to do. And also, it fits perfectly within the sort of the blind spots. You call them blind spots. You could just call it like they don't give a shit spots that the supposed right anti-interventionists have when it comes to Venezuela. Tucker Carlson has advocated for regime change in Venezuela as a counterpoint to not doing regime change in Syria. To this day, he'll still say, why aren't we getting rid of Maduro? His people are suffering. We don't need to get rid of Assad. We need to get rid of someone like Maduro. Like, I mean, he said things like that on his show.
Right, right.
Is that just him running his mouth? Or is it something actually deeper and more of a long-term plan where maybe Tucker Carlson is actually running interference for sort of an alternate track, quasi-neoconservative foreign policy platform, trying to kind of slyly advocate for regime change in Venezuela? You know, it's very, very Absolutely. Toxic that an quote-unquote anti-war guy is pushing regime change in Venezuela. And look very closely right now at what other people who are supposedly anti-intervention and see if they're talking about Venezuela and how we need to not overthrow the government there. And I think that's the litmus test right now for who is truly anti-interventionist. Well, because there's nothing to gain. You can only have things to lose by standing up for Venezuela.
Pompeo said right before this happened too, he said the time is now for a return to democracy in Venezuela. And then the day after he tweeted that, Pompeo's department said, quote, it's time to begin the orderly transition to a new government. And at the same time that this is happening, the opposition-controlled National Assembly was changing. They were trying to invoke this like article of the Constitution that just characterized Maduro as illegitimate and just said, okay, now the presidency is vacant. Okay, great. So you invoked some weird article that's actually that's nullified. You said that now the presidency is vacant. So guess what? I'm actually the president of America now, Robbie. Trump is no longer president. I, Abby Martin, I'm the president of the United States now, okay? Okay?
Yeah,
Everyone accept that?
So it's our legal right to take down Trump by any means necessary because he will not recognize you as president.
Right.
Fuck yeah, dude.
So China, now we need to call for China to come in, invade the U.S., and back me up, right? Install this violent military coup to propel me to become president of the United States. So please, I expect everyone to be in full support of this plan. And just an FYI, I mean, the opposition is so unpopular. So people come at me and they're like, Maduro's widely loathed. Everyone hates Maduro. Well, okay, that may be true that people don't like Maduro because, of course, how could you not reflect the leadership with like the economic turmoil that's been going on and been getting worse? Like, I understand that. People are exasperated because the economic war is very real and has very real life effects. But at the same time, he still is more popular than the opposition because the opposition, people understand the fascistic characteristics of the opposition. And that's why the opposition can't win elections. They can't really mobilize. And so just to really drive this point home, Venezuela Analysis brought up that this poll by the opposition, an actual polling group hired by the opposition called Data Analysis, showed that this body, the National Assembly, has a disapproval rating of 70%. So why is it that this overwhelmingly unpopular body was able to appoint this rogue opposition leader as head president of Venezuela? Throwing the Constitution out, because let's be real about what this means. This means that this guy is now going to be internationally protected. The U.S., all of these international bodies and NGOs are now going to just deal with this guy and act like he literally is the president, Robbie. All of the rules are going to be thrown out. The Constitution's going to be thrown out. It's suspending all rights and laws that were just gained by this constituent assembly, this kind of revolutionary constituent assembly that just happened last year that had an overwhelming democratic base. And it could potentially mean, let's be honest, it could potentially mean implementing fascist violence again on behalf of U.S. allies and proxies, Colombia, potentially the U.S. military. We know Trump loves to, he really wants to rape and pillage the countries that have resources. If they are not going to be able to win and cement the rule and oust Maduro, and you see, you know, it could potentially turn into a civil war type situation because they cannot impose this new leadership. The Chavistas and colectivos that are heavily armed are not just going to fucking sit back and let this happen. As Maduro has clearly elucidated, like, he has backing and they are fucking armed. So what's going to happen next? Will it be another Panamanian invasion, Operation Just Cause 2.0?
Yeah.
We don't know where this is going to go.
Well, yeah. I mean, it's kind of actually in a way that would be very much Trump style to do something right. like that. And man, I mean, during the government shutdown, when his popularity ratings are getting lower, even Michael Moore talks about this. I mean, this is what a lot of people... You know, it's the wag the dog concept. It's like when the president's unpopular, you know, the government's unpopular, start another war.
Right.
It's the oldest adage. I mean, so, yeah. We need to take this extremely seriously. And I already saw some, you know, a person from We Are Change tweeting out stuff that looked like like right-wing propaganda about it, showing like a million people cheering that this guy has been selected to be president or whatever.
Oh, are you surprised?
We no, I mean, it just,
went to
it's
the supermarkets
like,
and showed like is, the they pretended like it was like the Walking Dead.
This is going to be interesting because this might be where all these things collide. Why was the right being artificially boosted to be like they're anti-interventionists? They want to stop wars. Is lowering the bar of what being anti-war means part of the strategy by the war makers to get them to more easily able to start wars? You can't get rid of anti-war sentiment in the country. But what you can do is distort the playing field to make it seem like people who have terrible morals are actually anti-war. So you like muddy the waters and make people like confused about what actually being anti-war is.
And like siphon the energy.
Exactly.
Into
exactly.
Supporting
you know, so
people
bizarre,
like throwing
actually.
Throwing all of your weight behind candidates again. As
yeah.
if somehow change has ever happened from the top down. I mean... The craziest thing is that the Democrat, I mean, again, I always like the craziest thing about it. It's like so not crazy and completely normal. But the Democrats have completely endorsed this. The Democratic Party has said, absolutely, we do not recognize Maduro as a legitimate leader. So that's happening. And I think that our job first and foremost, please inform yourself. Please watch the reports that we did on the ground. We risked our lives to really tell the other side of the story for you, like, so we can understand what is happening and better fight against it. So we all need to understand and comprehend the situation, right? The problems and how the U.S. is actually affecting it, because we know that the sanctions have completely exacerbated the problem. We know that the U.S. government has paid tens of millions of dollars to these opposition forces over the past 20 years. The training of the Colombian cartels, like, all of this fits together. But the most important thing for us to do, other than be informed, is stand in a unified fashion against regime change. And it doesn't matter if you think Maduro's corrupt. Like, this is what we need to do. So join local actions. There's actions going on everywhere. There's an emergency rally being called tomorrow in LA. We're going to go. Link up with local groups and even just voice yourself online. Counter some of this propaganda, because it's really wall to wall. And we need to correct the record here, because no one else is really doing it. And it's gotten to the point, kind of like North Korea, where people have been so propagandized that they're saying, well, we have to do something, right? Well, this has to be good, right? Yeah, I don't support coups. Yeah, I don't like Trump, but, like, Maduro's bad. So whatever's going to come of this has to be better than what they have. That's where people are at. And we really, really need to break through that, because millions of people's lives are at stake. Tens of millions of people's lives are at stake.
And again, Venezuela is one of the only remaining countries in the world who actually stands up to the United States' rhetoric, who opposes many things symbolically and practically that the U.S. empire represents. So,
just it's like one of the last remaining independent countries.
Yeah, we need to stand up for countries that oppose the United States. And, you know, even if you disagree with some of the ways that they run their own country, I still think it's important. The U.S. still does not have a right to do those things.